Welcome to Transformation Station. My name is Laura and I'm a designer at Fontys Pulse, where we develop and execute educational programs based on design-based learning principles. In this podcast, I'm going to take you on a journey through our programs in order to explore the topics of design, education, and changing the world. In this first season, we're going to zoom in on design and education. Why do we need design in education? How do the two relate to each other? And what actually happens when you combine the two? In each episode, I will be talking to one of our team members, an expert in the fields of design or education, or, most importantly, our very own students. Through their stories, you'll find out how we are trying to achieve our mission of making education and life one. And maybe you'll even find some inspiration to start a transformation of your own. So without further ado, let's get into today's conversation. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second episode of Transformation Station. Today, I'm joined by the fabulous Marjoleine, and we will be talking about the self-directed professional. Hi, Marjoleine. Can you maybe introduce yourself?
Hi. I'm Marjoleine. You already have my name. And I work at Pulse as a self-directed learning and assessment expert. So I'm both... interested in how you learn as a person, but also how we can assess that as a minor perspective.
Cool. So can we maybe start your story at Pulse by how you actually got here and how you became the self-directed learning and assessment expert?
Yeah. what happened? I was... doing my final project at my master, which is at industrial design. And I was doing projects in education for a while, and it really interested me. But one of the hurdles in innovating in educational areas is always assessment, because if there are certain rules that don't facilitate innovations, then it's really hard to innovate. But if you can innovate with the assessment rules, then you can innovate within education as well. So my final project was about making rubrics. And rubrics is an assessment tool that teachers can use for soft skills. So instead of measuring if someone understands what 1+1 is with a clear answer, you can use it to kind of give an indication of the level of development of someone within, for example, collaboration. Are you very good in collaboration? Are you kind of good in collaboration? Are you terrible at collaboration? So developing that is very helpful to innovate the educational system as well, because then there can be more room to improve the soft skills in the program as well. And why is that important? Well, that's where it started for me, because I got into contact with Studio Tast. The Studio Tast collaborates with Pulse. So I worked together with Studio Tast first, and when I was finished with my project, they recommended me to Pulse. So that's how I got here. Then I started here as an assessment expert, because, you know, that's what I was doing for my graduation project. So I was working on the rubric, and I was looking around, like, how is the assessment going? And then I saw that a lot of students were making a portfolio. So they were working on, documenting their progress. But it was more of an administrational task than something they...
used to learn.
Yeah. So they didn't see the benefit for themselves. And for me, that was a real trigger, because I thought I hated to do something at school if I didn't see the benefit of it for myself. So then I thought, okay, so how can I help students or help or the, yeah.
Yeah.
Guide students in understanding and using the portfolio for themselves as well. And that's where the self-directed learning started to merge with the assessment, actually.
Okay.
And then,
because I had the idea that you were doing self-directed learning, but that you got here for, yeah, it's a new perspective for me as well.
Self-directed learning wasn't actually a part of the program. I just said, yeah, but that's self-directed learning. And then I got
here. We need self-directed learning.
Yeah, but we did it already.
Yeah.
We need to do more of that. So.
Okay, so how, what is then, can you maybe explain a bit more about then the difference between the assessment, which is then, okay, clearly the rubrics, and what self-directed learning then is?
Yeah, so, at school there is always a little bit of a friction between what a student wants to learn, what the student thinks is necessary, and what the student thinks is relevant, because that's always very personal.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone is different, has different experiences, so what I think is relevant or what I do and do not know is different from you, even
mm-hmm.
though we even went through the same bachelor and master degree.
Yeah.
But then at the same time, as a school or as an institution, you want to have a certain guarantee that all your students can do something or know something.
Mm-hmm.
So you always have the general guidelines, which is the assessment, but at the same time, very personal desires and learning dreams, whatever.
Learning dreams?
I don't know. So that's always, yeah. Yeah, it's really close, because you want those two perspectives to line up. That's,
mm-hmm.
you know, that would be nice.
Yeah.
But it's not always the case. So that's why self-directed learning and assessment, yeah.
So with self-directed learning, is it correct if I say that you actually try to give students sort of the freedom to achieve, like, the assessment goals, but also explore their learning dreams?
Yeah, yeah, I know. Also, like, I might like it to do research and watch tutorials when I want to learn something, but
mm-hmm.
someone else might like it to just try it out,
mm-hmm.
and just make it and then see what happens. So I have a very different approach to learning than someone else.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know, as an institution, you have a lot of students. They are persons. They're not robots. You can't all treat them the same way.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why self-directed learning is really nice. If you can give them the responsibility, like, hey, these are the criteria we set for you,
mm-hmm.
but at the same time you can make it relevant for you, and you can learn it the way you want to,
mm-hmm.
because you're also self-directed. So
how can we? How do you approach that then? In, for example, our minor program to
yeah.
guide students in this.
Yeah, that's always a bit tricky, because we have very different students.
Mm-hmm.
Some students are already really independent when it comes to, I don't know, planning holidays and their private life, but then join the minor and they're very passive. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know best, you are the teacher, what should I do?
Uh-huh.
And other students are already a bit more in charge, like, no, I chose this minor and I want to do this and that. So the first few weeks we start, we just let them be.
We just let them be.
Yeah, it's already a lot, you know,
yeah.
the detox week. Like,
yeah, we heard that last time.
Yeah, exactly. So that's, you know, let's wait for the right moment.
Yeah.
And then we just start by reflecting on what they've done. The interesting part is, as soon as you ask, yeah, but what do you think? That can be really shocking for some. Like, what? I have an opinion on what I do at school. No, but it's that usually...
I get to have an opinion.
Yeah, but usually it's the teacher who says, yeah, you did correctly, or no, you do not. How is your opinion relevant? So
mm-hmm.
asking that opinion and giving it value is already a really big step. So that's just the first
mm-hmm.
session. The second session is, okay... because we have assessment criteria,
mm-hmm.
We just introduce one.
Mm-hmm.
It's one goal. It's about technology
mm-hmm.
this time.
Because they're also really working with technology in the projects that they're doing right now.
Exactly. So we know that they are doing that.
Yeah.
And then we just start reflecting on, okay, so you did a project with a lot of technology. Make an overview of your process. How did that go?
Mm-hmm.
And funny thing is, some students actually ask, like, do I have to hand this in? And I was like, no, you're not doing this for me. You're doing this for you. You're learning more about something you already did. And it's a very funny mind switch, but it's beautiful to see. I mean,
Because what happens then? Because I think that a student actually asked you this.
Yeah.
What happens?
Well, I laughed. And then I said, no, of course not. Yeah, like, for me, that makes so much sense. I mean, why do I need
But how did the student respond to you laughing about that?
That was probably not the most correct response.
Well, maybe.
No, he was like, oh, okay. And it was also, you know, that was one reaction, but other reactions were like, oh, I need to take pictures of this, I need to store this, I need to document everything. So they were already working with that. So.
Why is that important then, that they're taking pictures? And
When you do a lot of things, and a lot of different things, we don't keep track of what they do exactly.
Yeah.
And we are also not very specific in what they learn during those activities, because that's different for everyone. So it's very important to document your story, your path, and reflect on what you learned from that, and then show that at the end. If you don't document it, I mean, I think nobody remembered exactly what he did half a year ago.
Yeah.
So, you know, shitty robot, I did something with, like, kids and technology. We want to see the process. We want to see actual experiences that you had, because then you can learn from it.
And
so that's why it's important.
And that then feeds back into the assessment rubrics.
Yeah.
Because so the students actually document their learning process.
Yeah.
And the extent to which they do that, I don't know. What is the relation between the learning process they document and the assessment then?
Yeah, we had a discussion. We had a very good discussion about this.
Because
yesterday.
We're also still developing this, right? Because
yes.
It's really difficult, because we have so many different students with different learning dreams.
Exactly. So, first of all, they document it, but then they also evaluate it themselves, and we ask them to ask for feedback.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not only your opinion, but it's also someone else's opinion.
Mm-hmm.
We partially do that because you can learn from someone else, you know.
Yeah. That's why we're doing this. I want to know what you're doing and learn from that.
So, you know, the feedback is helpful for your development as well. But at the same time, also, a little bit like that it's not only your perspective in your portfolio, but also someone else's. So when you document it, we also want you to link it to one of the goals that we have. We have 16 in total. They are called indicators, and they are grouped by learning outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
So those indicators, they are kind of mini goals for students.
We can put a link to the visuals in the description of this video, or maybe just put it in the video. I think that's helpful for people.
Yeah. And so it's up to them in the end to, even though they have a lot of experiences already, because we organize a lot of those experiences as well, it's up to them to link those experiences to the goals.
Mm-hmm.
And for them to realize, like, oh, I was doing this and this and that, and that helped me develop within my talents and what my talent is and in which context it flourishes. You know, oh, I discovered something about that when I was doing this. And isn't that during the shitty robot? So actively making that link and then storing it in a document, the Pulse Map. It's called the Pulse Map now.
Yeah.
That's actually already the portfolio. The Pulse Map.
Pulse Map.
The old portfolio.
Yeah.
So we switch names. It's very confusing sometimes. But so that's and then we look at, did you either make progress within the goal. So did you have a lot of experiences and, mm-hmm. and learn from that? So don't show what you did, but show what you learned from it. You know, the reflecting part is very important.
Mm-hmm.
Can you show me from an experience during the minor that you're already very capable of that specific goal? Because then you don't really have to develop. Because at the technology part, a lot of engineers, some want to be even better mm-hmm. at technology, others don't really want to. But in the identity part, they might grow a lot. So mm-hmm. they can kind of compensate which goals they already kind of achieved and others where they really want to grow in.
Yeah.
And then the final assessment criteria is can you the lesson that you learned from one experience, can you use that in a new context, in a different context, and can you relate that to your own professional life?
Mm-hmm.
So don't use it just in a
minor.
That
sounds really important.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's in boring language, it's called the transfer.
Yeah.
We call it ownership.
Yeah.
Can you use it for yourself?
Yeah, so basically we're saying, hey, it's cool that you did this in the context of the minor, but in order to actually become the self directed professional, can you also apply this skill or this knowledge or this
yeah.
insight to another aspect of your life or another aspect of your study or
yeah.
whatever?
Exactly. So that's why the main line of self-directed learning is learn from yesterday and vision tomorrow. So actively
mm-hmm.
consider how you would use that in the future, and then
yeah.
ideally already use it, of course.
Yeah.
But yeah.
So I heard reflection, I heard documenting, and there was another thing with the...
we call it basic level right now. That's the... If you're already really good, you can show it to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but all the things that you told me now were really related to, I think... The looking back, but we also mentioned the learning dreams, and you also
yeah.
say like envision tomorrow.
Yeah.
How does that relate to self-directed learning? Because, yeah, how do you create a learning dream? How do you
yeah.
get to a learning dream? Because
yeah,
that's really difficult.
That's a really tricky question. yeah, last time, so one of the things we do at the minor is we have 16 goals already prepared
mm-hmm.
for you. But we also have one open goal. It's called the expert goal.
Mm-hmm.
And a student defines that goal himself.
Mm-hmm.
Really cool. So I thought, you know, I give you 10 minutes, write your goal, and then we move on to planning that goal.
Yeah.
When you're going to do that. Because for me, that a lot happens already. I have a lot of, you know, I want to do more. I don't know if I'm ambitious in that way, but
yeah.
I already want to do this and this and that, and then I have to choose and prioritize
yeah.
instead of...
Yeah, but we were also, like, educated for 5 years to develop our own learning goals.
Seven.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
No, that's true. But
yeah.
for me, it was a really awkward realization that not everyone does that actively.
Mm-hmm.
So defining your own goal is pretty difficult, actually, apparently,
yeah.
For some students.
And you learned this last semester.
Yes. When I said, you have 10 minutes, write down, I actually said, write down 3 to 5 goals. 10 minutes, let's go. And then, you know, I was walking around like, why didn't you write down anything yet? Yeah, I don't know. What you don't know? Okay. So people don't actually know what they want to learn, because usually they are not involved in that part of learning, you know.
Mm-hmm.
An institution said, yeah, you should learn this and this and that. And if you ask a student, what do you think you should learn? That's not a question they hear very often. So apparently they need a bit more than 10 minutes to define that. So yeah, that's going to be a new challenge for this semester. But I involved some other people in that as well.
Uh-huh.
So yeah.
Cool.
But,
that also sounds to me like the most, like the reflecting and documenting, that's important to be able to showcase your learning. But really, how are you going to set up your goals and how can you guide students in finding their learning dreams? That sounds like a really inspiring part of
yeah.
self-directed
well,
learning.
The documentation is also inspiring because... it's very remarkable what you can learn from experiences if you look at it from a different angle. So not from the did I do well angle, mm-hmm. but like, what did I think of this? Did I like it? Why did I like it? Mm-hmm. What does this say about me? And then you can grow as a person. So that part is also really inspiring, but more in a looking back way. And mm-hmm. if you look ahead, then the question, what do you want to learn? What do you want to achieve? What is the impact you want to have on the world or on a person? Or what do you want to do with that? It's a very big question.
Yeah.
You can start a midlife crisis if you ask that. But, you know, how to make that process tangible, like from a very big dream to a concrete goal you can work on.
Yeah,
that's really interesting. In the end, I talked about it with my coaches. Mm-hmm. So we have personal coaching, and all the personal coaches talked with their students about their expert goal as well. So I think that's where most of the definitions happened.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to be interesting this semester how to do that.
Yeah.
It's a new challenge, because at first I started for the assessment part, but now I'm more into the self-directed learning part, and this is really an opportunity to, you know.
Yeah, so you already mentioned that you studied industrial design. How will design fit into this progress of you developing this self-directed learning?
Yeah. Yeah, well, first of all, it's about the approach. So you know, making iterations, accepting that an iteration is not perfect, but user testing it in the meantime.
Yeah, so for example, the course that you give last semester, and finding out that 10 minutes is not enough.
Apparently. So, you know, that, see it as a result of an iteration. So that is like design-based working. Well, I guess you're familiar with that.
Oh, yeah. It's my expertise.
On the other hand, I want to make it more tangible. So I already started visualizing and documenting some of the most important key ingredients so that mm-hmm. I can share it with the team.
Mm-hmm.
I also started with the goals, you know, we talked about.
Yeah.
They are now visualized in a way that's actually approachable and active or activating, hopefully,
yeah.
for students to work with, but also clear. We made videos for each learning outcome so that they don't only know better what it is, but can also look at it when it's relevant to them, because
and also know the experts that they have to get to
exactly.
if they want to learn more.
Exactly, so they know the community better as well.
Yeah,
and they can ask questions, so that's also very important. So those are some of the steps, and furthermore, I'm working on kind of. Well, not as I'm hypothesizing about working. I'm trying. Well, I will start working on a toolbox on steps you can take within different SEL phases. So, mm-hmm. for example, you have the orientation phase, mm-hmm. which is a very difficult one. Like, what do you want? What do you want to achieve?
Yeah.
So, how to get from a dream to a goal or multiple goals?
Yeah.
That's gonna be one part.
Well, that sounds like a really nice toolkit. How to get from a dream to a goal. That sounds super cool.
Yeah, but also it's a bit, it's kind of tricky to make, but we'll see, you know, just experiment.
I think you can do it.
We'll see what happens. Then you have the planning box. So that's got to be more about, you know, usually when you make a planning, it's not only about when are other people available, when are the materials that I need available, but also plan yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So, as a self-directed professional, you need to know what works for you.
Mm-hmm.
You need to make a plan you actually believe in, that you as a person can accomplish that.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes there is a mental state of mind that might not help you very much.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to change that a little bit and make it work for you. So plan your energy and your emotions as well. And not only the other people that you need and the environment that you need. Even though those two topics are important as well. So
for the feedback, you already had a tool last semester with the angel and the devil.
Yeah.
And the feedback roles, was it right?
Yeah.
I really like that one. It worked really well also in the future solution feedback sessions.
Yeah.
So I think that part's pretty covered already.
But that is more the evaluation part.
Okay.
Like, ask someone else to evaluate you and your work as well. So, but that's
good to know.
Well, I don't know. Maybe you can give feedback up front, feed forward.
Yeah.
But then it's not a peer review of something. It's more of a peer forward. I don't know. But anyway, so that's one. Then the other one is about mapping. So documenting your stuff and, managing your goals, because you probably don't have one goal. But if you're in the minor, you have 16 plus your own goals. So how do you manage your process? How do you keep overview of that? How do you document all your stuff? So I'm working on that also a little bit with Studio Task right now.
Mm-hmm.
And the final one, that's the evaluation part, with your opinion, someone else's opinion, mm-hmm. maybe multiple people's opinions.
That would be preferable.
That would be cool.
Yeah.
Would be nice. And that's the final part, so how to do that. And indeed, the peer review toolkit is a part of the evaluation.
Yeah.
Toolkit. Yeah, those are the four phases. I'm thinking of working on that. But at the same time, there's a lot to develop.
Yeah. Okay, so to round off, I have a last question for you. What are you most proud of what you've achieved within your expertise at Pulse up to now?
Ooh. I think the one I'm most proud of, it's not a happy experience, but I am kind of proud of it, but last semester, SEL and assessment come together within the assessment with the assessment of the portfolios, and when I looked at the portfolios, some were really cool and I really enjoyed looking at them. There were videos, there were websites, there were I don't know what was there. It was a lot of drawings.
Super inspiring.
It was really good to see how students actually use the opportunity to put their own communication style, their own identity in the portfolio as well. And I think that everyone who followed a minor and who followed our vision and met the criteria were also the ones that passed, and five students didn't, and it was really hard to say to someone, it's not according to our criteria, it's not enough for us to give you their credits. Because you can see that they developed,
mm-hmm.
but just not on the areas that
we
give the credits for.
Yeah.
So, but in the end, I do feel satisfied with the ones that didn't pass in a way like it. There was a reason that they didn't pass. It wasn't wrong. It took some real evaluation. I felt guilty at the beginning because I'm also responsible for the learning line as well. Like, did I do something wrong? Did I give them enough feedback? Didn't I help them enough? There's a lot of questions going on, but in the end, I discussed this with a lot of team members as well. They are the ones that are also not supposed to pass.
Mm-hmm.
So that's okay.
Yeah.
And I was actually really proud that the system that I kind of designed with Bart, really big credits to Bart, by the way, that it kind of worked. So the filter works and people take the opportunity, and that's really cool to see. And
some don't
for 100% meet the criteria, and that happens.
Wow.
But it did work.
Yeah.
It worked, so.
Super cool. Thank you so much for sharing and sharing your story and your thoughts. I really actually learned a lot from this, so thank you very much. Second episode.
Nice.
That's it for today's episode. If you want to know more about Pulst, our programs, and what our students get up to, you can find us on social media @FontesPulst on YouTube, Instagram, and LinkedIn, or visit our website, pulsed-edu.com. That's pulsed-edu.com. Or come visit us. We're in the S3 building on the TU campus, which is at Lismortel 25. And you're always welcome to come see our epic workplace and see what our students get up to in real life. And next to that, I would of course love to have you back for the next episode of Transformation Station. A new episode comes every 2 weeks, so I hope to see you in the next one.